general link data, and I'm Kalpagun Ratna, and myself and Mohib Alwash will present this. First part of the presentation, we'll try to introduce the link data techniques and few examples, and in the second part, Mohib will go along with some challenges he understood about the link data. So this is a this is adapted from a tutorial given at in 2013 in a W3C event. So when you talk about linked data, so the BBC is one of the major companies that uses linked data techniques and semantic web. So in their website, they adapted linked data and then semantic web technology. So their example from there is like they have these descriptions extracted from data available on the web. So for example, the argument for that maybe I can present. So editors for BBC can go and then collect information from other websites. Then it can go out of date. And the second scenario is like manually people can go and collect data from the web and create a web page again. But then if the data goes outdated again, web page goes outdated. In another sense, they can use APIs to collect data from other websites and then create their web page. Again, it can go out of date. So what they have done is like they used already existing and publicly available data sets, for example Wikipedia and then MusicBrainz. And Wikipedia extracted details are available on the Wikipedia, and then MusicBrainz has community generated information. So when they start using this, they can claim that their website gets updated automatically because it's not updated by a person who works for BBC, but it can get information and advantage from already available content on the web. So that's one example for using data on the web. So here's a screenshot example. So they collect information using MusicBrainz there. And then here's some Wikipedia snippets, so extracting data from Wikipedia. So when the Wikipedia article is updated, their website automatically gets updated. So data on the web as same as the web pages on the web. If they exist on the web like silos, nobody can use it, like it's isolated. So imagine where you have a web page, but you don't have links from your web page to another web page, or you don't have links coming to your web page to refer anything. So that means in page ranking the web pages, you will get low ranking from your web page. Same, like imagine a situation where the web page just doesn't have links, so you cannot traverse from one page to another. So for data on the web, and that leads to the linked open data or linked data, it is not enough that you just put your data on the web in some accessible form, but it should connect them each other, so it's you can traverse from one data set to another, as same as for web pages. So the idea is you can connect your data sets as same way that you do for web pages, so it's interconnected. So one of the basic things that we need to understand in using data on the web is like data integration. So I'll give one simple example. So what is about data integration? So for example, you get a book, an example, this is in English, and then you have a database of details for that book. So there are some entries on a relational database, for example. So then you can create, for example, RDF tuples for this information. So Yes, I just need a number for the book, and it's a title, and then year published. You can get RDF statements. And then there is, for example, there is another same book in another language, in French, for example, and then it has details. So for English user, you don't understand much here. And the same way, you can create some sentences here in RDF. So you have sentences created from that data. So you have two data elements available for the same book. So when you put them together, you have two data sources, but for an English speaker, you don't know about the green colored ones, but they are almost the same thing. So you can merge some of the similar ones. So here, the same book, so you can merge them together. And then by merging, you can take the advantage of some data not available on the first instance. It may be available on the second instance. So this integration and then aligning together, you can issue queries that cannot be answered in the first place, but after merging, you may have rich information. And also, in the next step, you can enrich your data if you want. For example, you can say these two items are talking about a person. So you get a person pointed to using a URI. So it says those two elements are referring to a person. Now you have one step, like you enrich your data, integrated data using some form of information external available on the web. And then you can use some other kind of data sets available on the web, so you can get more data which is not coming from the two data sources you already integrated. For example, you can get from DBpedia, which is you get details from Wikipedia. So here, for example, it get additional information from DBpedia, which is coming from Wikipedia again, and then add more information here. So you can enrich your data. That means first you get data from two different places, you integrate them, and then you also attach additional information available on the web. So you have like now information that wasn't possible thinking earlier. Now additional information. So the idea of present in this example is like now you can think earlier if you had one data element for the book, and then you couldn't get this much information from that alone. Then first you combine two sources, then you get some additional information. Then again, you bring in some external data sets or knowledge from other data sets, and then you put into integrated data. So you get more information. So the idea is like, can we do this on the web? Like putting data on the web like web pages. So the idea behind linked data is can be the same as this example. So what we have done in that example and on the web is like we put things using URIs. URI means uniform resource identifier. So on the web, everything is identified by an URI. So you put things on the web using URIs, and then when you type something in the URI, you get more information. So in that example, we got information for a person from DBpedia. So that's a URI. It had more information. So you got those information into your application or scenario. So you have URIs. When you want to dereference the URI, it gives you more information. So those two points are important to understand when you want to understand what is linked data and that concept. So we can move forward and go now? Like, what is linked data and how is it facilitated by semantic web technologies? So for the linked data, the concept began, the idea is introduced by Sir Tim Berners-Lee, saying the same way that you put web pages and create the web, put your data on the web and then link them together and then create the web of data. So it is facilitated by semantic web technologies, but in standards it's not encouraged that you use only RDF or semantic web technologies, but if you use it, it's more easier for the machines to process. But on the first level of introduction about the concept, he didn't mention about using only semantic web technologies, but from these days and now, people use semantic web technologies to publish data, so it's easier for the machines to understand rather than putting up some set of CSV files or relational databases just put online and then try to asking people to connect. But he already use a standard, so everybody agreeing on a standard, so that's not in the rules but encouraged. So not as a hard-coded rule, but data sets on the web, most of them have RDF, like triples. So we have learned about RDF in the class, so I'm not going to talk much about RDF here. So RDF, for completeness here, I present an example. So RDF sentence called a triple consists of subject, predicate and object. So you put your data in this format and then try to publish it. And in the RDF, you cannot do much. So there comes the use of RDFS, which is called RDF schema. So in there, you can structure your data set attaching a schema for it, like class hierarchy and additional information. So if you include a schema to your data set, that's additional information and additional knowledge. So you can do more if your data set is enriched with hierarchy or another step forward, like it has an ontology. So RDFS, you have classes and then predicates, you call properties. So classes have class subclass hierarchy, you can define in RDFS, and properties have property sub property relationship, and those things come in RDFS. And one other important details in linked data is people talk about using vocabularies to publish your data or already existing developed vocabularies. So the idea is people have developed some vocabularies that thinking that they are frequently used, for example SKOS and Dublin Core. Many data sets, if for example your data sets, you need to use some property or a class from those vocabularies, if you use it, that makes your data set and other data sets to interoperate better. It makes interoperability a much better case. So as we talked earlier, so data integration is a major thing that you want to achieve in when you have linked data or data sets available on the web in separate places, you want to integrate. So one other good thing is that if you use already developed or defined vocabularies to name your things on your data set, so it is easier for the integration because you are using already existing terms. We have examples along the line later. So here's some definitions for Dublin Core terms. It has term called abstract. You can, if say for a term in your data set you want to say an abstract, you can use this URI. So if you use this URI, that means it's already understood by most of the applications or systems that run on this data set, so you already getting back more rather than you try to define your own URI or your own concept. So that's the basic idea. So for DC terms, they use RDFS. That means it gets the capabilities of RDFS. It has class, RDFS class. This term is a, you can define it as a class. So for example, access rights is a property defined in Dublin Core metadata initiative, and then it comes with a predefined set of rules. So if you are agreeing to use this URI, these rules you already agreeing, and then it's already accepted, and people have thought about it before, so you get more comfortable in using this already developed vocabulary terms. So here are examples like definition for them. It has rate, domain, and range. And then now we come to like, we talked about the usefulness of integration and then some techniques that you can use. You can use vocabularies, you can use already existing techniques like RDF to publish your data. So now what link data or in open available data, we call it linking open data. So the project is called Linking Open Data Project. So this project came to life in 2008, 2009, that period. So people start putting data for their data websites or any kind of information that they have. So they've started putting data sets accessible online and then started linking them to other data sets. So that's the idea of link open data. So open means the data is openly accessible by anybody. If it is not open and is proprietary, for example, enterprise or the companies have their own linked data sets that's not accessible by others. So they maintain for their own purposes. So that's called enterprise linked data, or it's not called linked open data. But if you use these techniques to link your data sets by, with others, it's called linked data, but open means it's open to everybody. So here's the status of the linked open data cloud now. Like this was updated in this August. So you can see the nucleus or the main point in this cloud is Wikipedia, which is not surprising, it comes from Wikipedia. So everybody tries to connect to Wikipedia. And then Wikipedia has connections to others because Wikipedia is like encyclopedia data set. So some data sets here are domain specific, so it doesn't have many links or coming going with other data sets. So here, for example, this green area is for publications, I guess. So data sets are for IEEE or ACM, like published conference data sets there. So domain specific, and these are like domain independent encyclopedic data sets. So publishing these data sets, there's a star schema. You star your data to publish on the web. So at least you need to have a first star, that means make it available on the web somehow, some format. And then it should be machine readable. That means some kind of extracted information from, and for example, don't, if you only publish the image, you can't get much information out of it for a machine. So the second point is like make it machine readable. Third one is about not to use any proprietary formats or standards, and make it open. And the last one is like link it to other data sets as many ways as you can. So it's interlinked, so you can jump from one data set to the other. These are the these are called five stars. They are not the rules for you to publish the data set. There are four roles to publish data sets that are defined from the very beginning. So these are the rules. So first one is use URI to denote anything. So you have come to know about the Internet of Things, so they started using URIs for everything. So the same thing happens here. Even for Internet of Things, you have data for that on the web in a URI form, that's data accessible on the web. And then the second one is like use HTTP URIs so people can look up the data. So that's easy to get and then get the information. And then the third one is it's not enough for you to put a URI and do nothing. If somebody wants to type that URI and see what happens, he should get back some information about that URI. So the URI alone is not sufficient, it should return back something if you look up. And also the fourth one is link to others. So if you don't have links, you cannot call it as linked data or linked open data, it should be interlinked. So here it says linked data normally is based on RDF because almost every data set or many data sets published use RDF. But the most important thing is it should be dereferenceable. It should give back something meaningful. So as I told earlier, DBpedia is one of the major and then very data set that was there from the very beginning, so it was created using Wikipedia. But the important thing is DBpedia, it doesn't have all the information, it has only information extracted from the infoboxes. Infobox is called this part in Wikipedia, so that automatic processing agents just process this box structured information on each Wikipedia page, extract it and then convert it into RDF format and then publish them. So that's called DBpedia. So you cannot expect every information on the Wikipedia to be available on the DBpedia. It has the information available on infobox parts only. And then how you link them is one example here. So here the top part, it's related to this URI. Is the DBpedia URI that you have for the city called Kolkata. And it says it is the same with Kolkata that is mentioned in Freebase and then in GeoNames. So what it is called linking is like you can point from DBpedia to the GeoNames saying it is the same thing. So you use all same as concept. And you don't necessarily have to use the same as only, you can say some other link as well. So RDFSC also, it's a property, so it links back to DBpedia saying this doesn't say it is the same thing, but it is linking to DBpedia again. So the applications using, let's say your application starts processing DBpedia here, the next, if you want, you can jump to GeoNames and get additional information like longitudinal latitude, those information. And then from, for example, from here, you can jump to some other data set. So you can collect information on the web as if you are browsing like web page. So that's the idea, like linked data and putting on the web. And one other thing is like you can create links not on the instance level. For example, this the earlier example connecting these two URIs are on the instance level. It's not on the class level, but you can also connect links in the class level if you have ontology or hierarchy. That's called class level agreement. So you can make links between datasets in any form. So here we come to the example again. So it has information extracted from these available data sets on the web and then from Wikipedia. And then this is an example that you see for this artist on DBpedia in RDF format. So this in the background is RDF, but this uses a service that can render those RDF statements in text. So the tool that used here is called PuBby, and then there are several others. So underneath you have the RDF data, and on top of it there is a server that runs on it. So when you type a URI on the web page, that translates into a web page, not just raw RDF data. So it's a human can read and then easier to read. And then this is the this is what it may look like in RDF name-3 format, the same thing. And then same information in different sites. Same thing mentioned here, so use web technology for data publishing data on the web, and use HTTP, and then you can get information back. And you might have the question, like, you can only read data from this link to open data or link data, so what happens if you want to write it back? So there is a W3C group working on making the link data or link to open data, anything, make read and write accessible. So they are making a platform, so anybody who uses datasets can use that platform, so you can write it back to the dataset and also read it back. So then it will be like read, write, link to open data or link data. So from here onwards, he will start giving his insights and then.
So before publishing your data, there are some considerations that you need to take them as practices. For example, don't focus first on the data itself. Then you can work on the interface, and also consider adding links to other entities in your data. In addition, your data might be others might depend on your data. So consider persistence and versioning on your data, and also be careful when you use the URIs that you select and vocabularies. Also, don't forget to include documentation providing the data for what you publish. There are also some tools that can be used, for example, data catalog vocabulary that will help you in identifying these things. This is an example of published data. For example, this is the first one is a raw data. Here is an HTML file with RDFA, and this is the actual HTML that represents all of those. So to query linked data, there are several approaches, but we will discuss only two. The first approach is to use linked data platform. It is a simple way to that is proposed by W3C, and you can use HTTP to get, post, update, or delete from linked data. The problem with this one, when you deal with complex RDF data. So in this case, the solution is to use SparkUI, which is easier to deal with complex data. And it's basically, you can use HTTP request to an endpoint, SparkUI endpoint, to get the data in the format that you want. But the problem, there is the problem with RDF schema, it doesn't have enough vocabulary to cover everything that you have. So there is another proposal to organize your data. It's called Simple Knowledge Organization System, or SKOS. It is also recommended by W3C. It's used to organize your data, classification, schema, taxonomies, and other things. And for advanced vocabulary, we use OWL. This is an example of how the data are organized with SKOS for animal, cat, and domestic. How do we organize this data with this basically, from the graph, we will work up the F-type SQLOS concept. And here we will just preference label, which is human readable format. It's the same thing with animal. And also, here we just put a browser, which means a browser knowledge for that one, and related field, which is wildcat. And this is the overall connection using SKOS. Also, it can be used to connect to other knowledge organization data using. I mean, you can connect. You can use this technology to connect with other data sets.
Any questions, guys? Yeah.
So one thing here is like if you just use OWL, it has OWL famous only in defined in OWL language. Here they came up with like scores, exact match, and broader match. If you use exact match, that is similar to OWL famous, that means exact same thing. But broad match, you see like cat and animal is not exactly the same thing. But if you only use OWL, you cannot make that link. So these vocabularies make you use whatever you want to do better. So you can use them. So it's already accepted standard.
So broad match is more like a subset of.
Yeah. But it's on the individual level, not class level. You have subclassing in the class level, but here it can be an individual. Or it's defined, so you can use it with individual graph, like instance.
So basically, it can be used for concept grouping, like SKOS collection, member of, or documentation example, or extension for more complex representation. Also for, But the problem with SKOS, it's only simple vocabularies. It doesn't satisfy all what we want. For example, if we want to characterize the properties or identification of objects with different URI, or disjoint or equivalent of classes, we cannot use SKOS. And instead, we can use OWL for this purpose. OWL is, you can consider it as an extra layer over RDF, and it has its own namespace and own terms. So, for example, for classes, you can use OWL, equivalent class, if you have two classes and you want them to be equal to each other, or for properties, equivalent to properties, for authors also. For example, this author is equivalent to this one, if you use equal property. And for individual, same as different from. And this is just a picture to show how the connection with OWL. Here also, if we want to connect to data set, for example, we connect this data set with this data set using OWL, same as. There are some challenges with linked data. For example, assume that we have two entities and we want to connect entity A with entity B. Then all links of entity A should be also linked from both sides. So if we change any link from entity A, then we should change these links from entity B. And this is one of the challenges in linked data. Also, querying the data, querying the work of data is different than querying conventional databases, because it's hard to have complete catalog that can cover all the entire linked data. consider this example. If we have a query that asks for phone number of people who authored a data integration related paper and at the European Semantic Web Conference, then basically we will need to collect data from different data sets. But how are we going to connect, or how do we retrieve these data sets to answer our query? So there are two ways to solve this this problem. The first one is by having a data warehouse, and the second one is using federated query processing. With the data warehouse, it's like copying everything to a centralized location. Like, for example, with Google search engine, they collect everything in a centralized location to process the data. The pros for this solution is instant query result, but the problem with it is setting up the environment, maintenance, and cost. And you cannot get up-to-date information. If something changed, then you need to copy everything to that place and process it. The other solution is to use federated query processing. You will get up-to-date information using this solution, but it is limited to entities that have SparkQL. Anything, any connected data, linked data, connected and doesn't have SparkQL, it will be excluded from this solution. So here are some of the areas that linked query processing selection techniques. The first one is data source selection. It has live observation, index-based, hybrid approach. And the second one is data source ranking, where you rank the data based on the URIs. And the third one is integration of data retrieval and result construction. And the fourth technique is the traversal-based query execution. So in conclusion, linked data and related technology are there to integrate data on the web. We have a debate on what is linked data is and how can we handle it. So assume those are HTML website that they have RDFA. Each page has all this information. They have RDF inside that page. And all of these pages are linked together and linked with DBpedia. DBpedia have linked to these pages. Can we call these pages linked data, part of linked data or not? Since there is the problem with, from my viewpoint, from what I understand, we can extract the RDFA. For example, here, we just submit this HTML page and we get the RDFA or RDF data from that page. So the data can be extracted right away from here to get RDF, RDF files from the HTML page. They can be separated. So do we consider this one as part of linked data or only the data that have only databases like DBpedia and other data set that has only database? You want to present the viewpoint from here?
We had that data graph.
So I need your contribution to solve this issue. Can show the graph.
Well, if you're even if you're using, would you be able to query that web page using either federated query or another means to access the RDF data directly from the HTML, or does it need scraped and stored before you can query it?
You can access it directly. You can remove everything and get the update or update only. Do we consider this only linked data or anything outside this graph but linked to it, and it doesn't have a formal database, a linked data? All of these here, they have database and they have Sparker endpoint where you can query the data right away. But from this point, now we have normal websites that have RDFA, and it does the same functionality as those. We can extract information from here. But the problem is they have HTML and RDF at the same time. Do you have input?
No. There's no question in this one.
No, we have a debate. We want to get an answer for this one. Do we consider normal HTML files that have RDFA and linked with, for example, DBpedia, and they have their special URI part of linked data or not?
Well, I mean, one simple answer would be that does it satisfy those four or five principles? Mm-hmm. And second is whether you want to call the metadata of this kind to be linked data, or you simply want to say that here is some data where metadata constitutes annotation with linked data. DBpedia is clearly a component of linked open data. But whether the particular annotation that you have, which is in a particular HTML page.
HTML, but they are connected with other pages, connected with DBpedia.
Right, but the connection that you're making is from the page to DBpedia, and not from, basically, that's what I was saying. If you could call a query on that web page and get a result like you would get the result from DBpedia, then I would consider it, yes, that's part of linked data. It's using linked data because it's using data from DBpedia, but it is not itself linked data.
Right, but you can query. I mean, any web request is a query of the web server, right? So.
Right, but I mean, the web page doesn't have a Sparkle.
I agree. It doesn't have a way of getting multiple results back
right. From
a single query. And so that makes it hard to use, but that doesn't necessarily mean
so
it's
in
not
general,
in open data.
Yeah, in general, philosophically also, first of all, technical issues, whether it satisfies those principles or not, and you are talking about whether something is available as an endpoint and is queryable and what recorded results give you. That's one point. The philosophical viewpoint, conceptual viewpoint would also be that linked data is sort of a structured data that is reusable for others, and it's like a database on the web of sorts, right? And it is like interlinked database on the web. So earlier we used to have, and today you have standard databases like SQL databases, which are not web accessible. Well, here the data is web accessible. You have traditional databases which are not that well interconnected, unless there's some level of foreign key or something connected at the application level. There is no data level connections. Well, linked data has data level connections because people realize that you're going to have data from multiple sources. There will be duplicates, there will be synonyms, there will be relatedness of different forms, and you want to interlink these space, right, that are complementary or overlapping. And so you have a, you know, very important concept. The linked data did suffer initially for several reasons. Among one was indifferent quality of the data, because anybody can put up the data in a, and the data itself, you know, structurally is following these principles, but the quality of data is just not good. You call that sort of open data, but what good does it do? And you don't know what quality. So reusability would suffer, or people won't want to use it because quality is not clear. Other thing was that you just put up the data and not realize that this other data that has exactly the same meaning and purpose, so you're now creating duplicates. And that doesn't help much either. So from the very early part, what was noticed is that because Wikipedia has general purpose knowledge for the world, you know, it's collective, you know, crowdsourcing and collective intelligence in some sense. The DBpedia had very broad variety of data, and it became the core reference point. So there were a lot of links with DBpedia. Whenever possible, people put up some link in the DBpedia. But with major caveat, that the links typically people tended to putting were, you know, it's not like putting link at all the levels in an information representation, like high level concept. For example, Dayton, and Dayton has Art Institute, or Dayton has you know, Air Force Museum, and it's not going at all the levels. It will be making connection at some arbitrary level for that piece of information. You know, you have concept like Dayton, but Dayton or a city will have art institutes, have educational institutes, would have businesses, would have all these kind of things, right? People may make reference to a very broad concepts, but not at the lower level. So the utility of making connections at a very broad level is partly useful, but not necessarily so, because the whole idea of what is represented about Dayton, all the different components of Dayton, are simply not considered. If you think about, let's say, that information about Dayton came from Wikipedia page about the Dayton, right? It has all these different things that I mentioned. And there happens to be Dayton of in a totally different context, and you just link it, you're giving partial context, you're doing partial thing. That is good if that's all you care for. But what if the other side also has some subset of the data, and you don't do anything about them? You don't resolve, oh, but this data here is the same as that there, if they were duplicate. You don't do that, you just put the link at the top. That creates, you know, imbalances that really are not, that have partial, you know, that makes it harder for other applications to use the links, the fact that somebody said that this is all data and this is also data. That's one thing. Then there are, you know, so there are links typically at the high level, but not at the detail level of data, because that would be too much work. So people did not do too much work. People put up just their data to get a satisfaction that that data is on the web, but quality may not be good, and the connectivity was not very good. So these are just some of the challenges with the link open data. Coming back to the question that was debated here, basically, the use of linked data, here you're actually using linked data to attribute meaning to RDFA for some object on the page. But you're really not making that data on the page to be the full member of the link open data. So I would tend to basically say it's really not part of the linked data in itself. Now, suppose I have a very large website. And suppose I actually annotate all that pages on the website. And then I export those annotations with you know those principles in mind. Now, of course, then those annotations become part of the linked data. That would be appropriate. They'll be well-connected possibly. They'll be reusable. They'll become vehicle for others to use that metadata you know, in linked paper data and come to your page at some point. Or further details, like say text, to look at the text.
But in this case, how are we going to use Sparkle with, for example, pages like this that doesn't have Sparkle endpoint?
No, if you put up the data on the link open data, you probably are going to have this problem.
Right, he's saying you're basically gonna scrape the page for those annotations and put them in a database.
But dump file.
His argument is that you don't put it on a web page, you extract it on the fly. Or
dump it in a file and next to the web page and put a URI for it, or without losing Spark UI. I mean, is it possible to have linked data without losing Spark UI?
But then you have published your data.
You can have open data, but not linked data. You can have XML-based open data, you can have use other technologies to put up open data. But the word linked data has been corrupted, in my view, with regards to these principles that includes use of RDF, basically, and then as Sparkle to query it.
Okay.
And it's fundamentally what we are doing. Fundamentally, you are saying that each data item would have URI, and hence it exists up there in the web. Secondly, you would be in principle the intention, even if not practice, is that I have some data on the web, then I will do my reasonable attempt to link that, to connect it to other things which are exactly the same or similar, or other things through relationship. I have a problem with majority of the use of linked data, that you just publish data, the power is lost. Remember in one of the earlier discussions, I mentioned the relationship at the heart of semantic web on core to the semantics. So you publish the data and you can use it as a reference, there is some power to it. And there's power to the level of entity to use it. But there is not the full power to it, because the relationships are not fully exploited. But nevertheless, there can be some. So suppose I had web pages that were on periodic table, all the elements of periodic table, right?
Mm-hmm.
And suppose I annotated all of them, suppose I extracted all that data and put it up on link open data. This would be valuable. So assume that there's no other exactly the same data that already out there. No, this would be valuable, because this is a reference data in itself. And just the fact that this element has this weight and name is value in itself, and it's reference worthy information. So that would be fine. But there's a lot of other data where without relationship you're only giving entity level information, not the full information that a relationship thing would have. Right? So remember earlier talk, and remember the I had shared with you earlier when I wrote about 15 years of semantics, there was a link to 2008 keynote I gave at ER where I talked about, in 2002 also, but where I talk about keywords and entities and relationships and events, right? And then I also drew the analogy to what Google started talking about, strings, not things, not strings. They came up with that in 2002.